What's the harsh reality no one accepts? Very late, but sometimes you are the problem in a relationship. And if people keep on leaving you, it may well be your fault. Even if you don't feel like it is. You're the bad guy in someone's story. So many of your enemies will never admit to doing anything wrong, but the thing is, neither will you. In some situations, people justify their own behavior to themselves. That's why so many people can't apologize and double down on the things they do. Some parents just don't love their children. I was reading an article about 10 things therapists don't tell you. And one of them was that many parents admit they don't love their children. This one scares me. Edit found the article. Not the most scientific. As to why it scares me. When my son was born, he was more a stranger in my house and it was not a love at first sight. I was happy to some extent but never felt like you see in movies. I talk with therapists and be reading about it here and there. Not uncommon for dads to have to work on bonding with newborns. Son is now 10 months and much improved on bonding. But you always kind of judge how you initially reacted and if that's who you really are, etc. It would help if people actually gave a thought into having kids and didn't just have them because it's what you're supposed to do. Sometimes you must accept the truth that there always will be idiots who will eat up for rest of us. And sometimes that idiot will be you. If Shrek 5 happens, it's going to be a cash grab and Shrek is probably going to do the floss. Please don't say things like this, I don't want to think about it. This is a harsh reality I can't accept. Hard work doesn't always pay off. Something I learned my first week in the corporate world, and again even up until all the coronavirus layoffs. A non-executive's value to the company is strictly dictated by which side of the balance sheet their compensation falls. I'm thankfully in a job that's considered overhead, but I'm still employed. Quality is, by many companies, as only a cost. It's very frustrating, because in actuality it's cost avoidance. You spend X dollars now, and prevent Y dollars in loss later. Mistakes do define you. The little ones don't, but if you make a big mistake, it will alter your life to an extent. Saying that they don't matter is a lie that will prevent you from diagnosing life problems later, down the line. This is something I wrestle with a lot in terms of my recovery from alcoholism. I quit at 24 and have been sober 7 years without relapse. Despite that accomplishment, I have alcoholic neuropathy that will never go away no matter how long I'm sober. This is a wonderful accomplishment though. Quitting is so hard, even if you have every reason to. You chose life. Some people just can't be saved. You could give them every benefit in the world and they still could choose to throw it all away and you can't do anything about it. This is a tough lesson to learn. People have to want to change. Nothing you can do can make people change if they're resistant to it. Sad face edit. Thank you so much for these awards, kind strangers. NGT. Nobody is truly selfless, and that's okay. There's a guy named Robin Hanson who's an interesting thinker and he's co-authored a book called The Elephant in the Brain about the hidden motives in our daily lives. The book says exactly what you say, but Hanson doesn't seem to find that depressing or disheartening. As far as I remember, he put it like this: humans don't look that bad when compared to other animals. The only way we look bad is when we compare ourselves to the angels we pretend to be. Reminds me of a quote. Limited in nature, infinite in his desires, man is a fallen god who remembers the heavens. Alphonse de Lamartine. Bad things will happen to you for no reason. I always like the Star Trek quote, it is possible to commit no mistakes and still lose. That is not a weakness. That is life. For that reason. Some things just happen and that's the way it is. That quote made me start watching Star Trek TNG on Netflix. Without exaggerating, it is one of the best shows ever made. Edit, I've gotten some of the same questions, so let me answer them here. Do you need to watch the original series first? No, I started off from Star Trek TNG Season 1. It was rougher than the later seasons. Episode 2 was really bad, but I read up on it on Wikipedia and found it was considered the second worst episode of the entire series, haha. I'd recommend watching from Season 1 and just power through into Season 2 when things really pick up, with the Measure of a Man episode being considered the starting point of where it became great. Anam, #X200B, what's a good episode to get hooked by? Some of the best episodes requires, emo, that you have gotten a better feel for the cast so you understand them better and can sympathize with them better. Or that you follow the plot. But the following are good episodes off the top of my head that stand well on their own. The Inner Light, Season 5, Episode 25, Elementary, Fear Data, Season 2, Episode 3, First Contact, Season 4, Episode 15, Someone Recommended, and so you know which episodes to skip. They recommend the following taste test episodes: The Defector, Season 3, Episode 10, Data's Day, Season 4, Episode 11, Timescape, Season 6, Episode 25, Is It Like Star Wars? Well, it takes place in space, but it's different. Star Wars takes place in a galaxy far away, whereas Star Trek takes place in our galaxy. At some point, Earth came up with a warp drive, which allowed for faster than light travel. We quickly came into contact with our galactic neighbors and it went on from there. TNG takes place in the 24th century, when Earth and the Federation of Planets it is part of constitutes one of the main powers in this quadrant of the Milky Way. We have reached a post-capitalistic society with matter replicators that allow us to create whatever food, drink or other item we want, holodecks that allow us to live out virtual reality and simulate NPC beings, and other cool tech. Still, despite this, we are still human, and Star Trek does a wonderful job of exploring many of the ethical and philosophical questions we've been dealing with since ancient times, as the goal of the Enterprise is to explore the Milky Way for new life. For example, what is life? How would we recognize it, whether it be silicone-based, pure energy, simulated, or even artificial life in the form of androids, robots, nanites? Star Trek also touches upon questions of leadership, authority, military, navy life and politics. The Enterprise is formally on a mission of exploration and research with a crew reflecting that. But they're also all ranked members of the Starfleet, and not all races they encounter are friendly. Other interesting races sharing our galaxy include the Klingons, a warrior race, quite barbaric in looks and behavior, but they live by their own sense of honor, similar to the samurai Bushido. In the original series, they were enemies of the Federation, but in between that and TNG, they formed an alliance. The Romulans, a space version of the Roman Empire. They care only for the glory of their empire and share a DMZ, neutral, zone in space. They're cousins of the Vulcans and are also very logical, but fascistic and greedy. Ferengis, weird and annoying, they are super greedy and are motivated by profit above all. Kinda like the goblins in Harry Potter. The Q, literally omnipotent beings. For some reason, a member of the Q continuum has taken an interest in us humans and likes to mess with us. The Borg, cybernetic organisms linked in a hive mind called the Collective. Their sole goal is to expand across the galaxy and assimilate other civilizations and their technologies. Resistance is futile. The Bajorans, a highly culturally advanced race, turned into space refugees after their home planet was annexed by the highly militaristic Kardashians, and more. They're also human-like races who just live differently. Like a planet of clones, or a planet of genetically engineered people. Have you watched DS9? No, I'm almost done with TNG and I'm looking forward to watching it afterwards. Thanks everyone for your recommendations. Pain is inescapable. Not even acknowledging that pain is inevitable and preparing for it ahead of time can lessen it. You will be taken by surprise, you will be hurt, you will not enjoy it, you will not be able to numb it, and there is nothing you can do except take it on the chin. Edit, I guess I should add, it's true you can prepare yourself to experience certain kinds of pain and lessen its impact, but when I said this, I meant that eventually something was going to come up that you never prepared for and cause pain. Anyway, just didn't do a good job of making that clear, sorry. Oh, and yes, pain can also bring about growth, I don't disagree with that at all. I am reminded of an iconic quote from Robert Heinlein's Stranger in a Strange Land, and I paraphrase, I have discovered why humans laugh. Not because there's a levity, but because there's a wrongness. Humans laugh because something is wrong. All human beings are capable of being viciously immoral. There's a point where we can be forced or force ourselves to become completely animalistic. We can perpetrate murder and genocide, as just one example, and if justified to ourselves correctly, we will feel no remorse. We like to think that the only people capable of such horror are a minority, but the truth is that we are all capable of it given the right circumstances. There is a Star Trek film that deals with this. Nemesis. Basically, a clone of one of the virtuous characters shows up hellbent on destroying humanity. The captain pleads with him at one point, saying that the man he is couldn't possibly do the things he is. He is better than that. His blood is better than that. The villain responds, he is what his life has made him. More befitting here is, I'll show you my true nature, our true nature. You don't always keep the good friends you meet. But that doesn't mean you can't make more later on down the road. From the BoJack Horseman finale, and something I've realized and made peace with, I think there are people that help you become the person that you end up being, and you can be grateful for them, even if they were never meant to be in your life forever. Alexa, play Mr. Blue. Very few people truly accept their mortality, and most of the time when it truly sinks in, people get scared and want to avoid it. Keeps me up at night, sometimes with a dread swelling in my stomach. Edit, and just like that, my fears have become my most upvoted post. This world. I feel mine in my heart. Beauty matters in how people treat people. I am ugly. On one hand, I get very often treated worse just because I am ugly, but on the other hand, people don't expect me to be valuable, which means they don't pretend to like me just for personal gains, and when they do, it's so obvious. Saves me a headache. I think one of the perks of being unattractive is not, or rarely, receiving unwanted attention. Like being invisible. I like that. Some people just don't get a happy ending. Some people never find happiness or satisfaction. People tell you that there is light at the end of the tunnel, but for some people, there isn't. They never get to see any light, just darkness. Yeah, I once lived with someone like that. She was in her 70s, 80s, and I rented a room in her house for a few months. She was truly miserable. She told me about how she grew up in Turkey with an absent father and abusive alcoholic mother. She told me how she escaped her overbearing family by marrying an Indian diplomat. Then how her husband abused her for years. Then when her family moved to Canada, how she worked for years for her husband and kids with no thanks. By the time I moved in with her, she was all alone, living in low-income housing, yelling at her kids on the phone once a week about how they are terrible children who never visit, and ranting to me about how terrible her life had been and how many regrets she had. She was an awful person to be around, but it was clear she had lived a life full of suffering.